We continue with the ringing of the church bells. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to grant us forgiveness.
Let us kneel. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against thee by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to thine infinite mercy, seeking and imploring thy grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ.
O most merciful God, who has given thine only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake grant us remission of all our sins, and by thy Holy Spirit increase in us true knowledge of thee and of thy will, and true obedience to thy word, that by thy grace we may come to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our heavenly Father, hath had mercy upon us, and hath given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgiveth us all our sins. To them that believe on his name, he gives power to become the sons of God, and bestows upon them his Holy Spirit. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. Turn unto me and have mercy upon me, for I am desolate and afflicted. Look upon my affliction and my pain, and forgive all my sins. Unto you, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. O my God, I trust in you. Let me not be ashamed.
Thank you.
is strong, nothing is holy. Increase and multiply upon us your mercy, that you, being our ruler and guide, we may so pass through things temporal that we finally lose not the things eternal. Through thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with thee in the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end. The Old Testament reading is from Jeremiah chapter 28. Then the prophet Jeremiah said unto the prophet Hananiah in the presence of the priests, and in the presence of all the people that stood in the house of the Lord, even the prophet Jeremiah said, Amen, the Lord do so. The Lord perform thy words which thou hast prophesied, to bring again the vessels of the Lord's house, and all that is carried away captive from Babylon into this place. Nevertheless, hear thou now this word that I speak in thine ears, and in the ears of all the people. The prophets that have been before me and before thee of old prophesied both against many countries and against great kingdoms, of war and of evil and of pestilence. The prophet which prophesieth of peace, when the word of the prophet shall come to pass, then shall the prophet be known that the Lord hath truly sent him. This is the word of the Lord. For today is Romans chapter 6. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lusts thereof. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death, or of obedience unto righteousness? But God be thanked that ye were for servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. Being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men, because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as ye have yielded your members servants to uncleanness, and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness. For when ye were servants of sin, ye were free from righteousness. What fruit had ye then in those things whereof ye are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now being made free from sin, and become servants to God, ye have your fruit unto holiness, and the end, everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Here ends the reading. Cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. I will call upon God, and the Lord shall save me. He has delivered my soul in peace. Alleluia, alleluia. I will love thee, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. Alleluia. The Holy Gospel is recorded in Matthew chapter 10, reading from verse 37. Please read. Jesus says, he that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me, and he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. He that findeth his life shall lose it, and he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. He that receiveth you receiveth me, and he that receiveth me receiveth him that sent me. He that receiveth a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet's reward. And he that receiveth a righteous man in the name of a righteous man shall receive a righteous man's reward. And whosoever shall give to drink unto one of these little ones a cup of cold water, only in the name of a disciple, verily I say unto you, he shall in no wise lose his reward. This is the gospel of the Lord.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. God's word for us today is from today's gospel lesson. The story is told of a traditional and typical Lutheran church on a Sunday morning. The head usher was standing at the top of the steps to pass out bulletins to all who would arrive. And just before the service started, an elderly lady came and said, "Sir, I want to be seated in the front pew right underneath the pulpit." And the usher said to her, "Oh, ma'am, you don't want to do that. The pastor we have right now is a terrible pastor. He has horrible sermons. You'll fall asleep in the front pew. I suggest you sit someplace else." And the lady said to the usher, "Do you know who I am?" The usher said, "No." She said, "I am the pastor's mother." And the usher said to the lady, "Do you know who I am?" She said, "No." And he looked up and said, "Thank you, Jesus." Well, my mother is in heaven, and nobody's in the front pew, so I'll continue with my boring sermon. Our gospel lesson today continues from last Sunday, and Jesus talks about where he has come not to bring peace, even though he's called the Prince of Peace, that spiritual peace, but to bring a sword. And there will be trouble between man against his father, daughter against his mother, daughter-in-law against mother-in-law, and so forth. What Jesus is teaching us here is that because of our Christian faith, oftentimes that causes strife and trouble in relationships with spouse or children or relatives or friends or neighbors. And the reason that it causes strife and trouble is because our Christian values and morals are oftentimes diametrically opposed to the values and morals of the society and the world in which we live. That's because we are sinners living in a sin-filled world. And just because sometimes Christians think we should have an easier life here because we are Christians, Jesus says no. Specifically because you are a believer in Christ Jesus, you will have a more difficult time in life because of your Christian faith. "Anyone who loves his father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves son and daughter more than me is not worthy of me." God must be number one in our life, and everybody and everything follows thereafter. And then Jesus says, "Anyone who does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me." Now, what is your cross? Your cross is all the troubles and tribulations and trials that you have in daily life. And we all have them because we're all sinners. It all goes back, of course, to our first parents in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, you know. They fell into sin. And so this is the path that we have chosen, alienation from God. Now remember, God is holy and just, and nothing unholy or unjust can come from God. Only good comes from God. So all the evil in the world, all the trouble in our lives, is because of sin. And as St. Paul said in our epistle lesson, the wages of sin is death. Temporal death and eternal death. And so what trouble do you have? What is your trial and tribulation? What is your cross that you are carrying this morning? As you know, my wife and I lost our 51-year-old son, John, 2.5 months ago. That's one of the crosses that we bear. And every Sunday, I'm so happy that you pray for our 53-year-old daughter, Libby. And she, of course, is also suffering from cancer of the bone marrow, and of the brain, would you believe? Now, thankfully, right now, her chemo is kicking in, and she's doing quite well. So continue to pray. But that's some of the crosses that we carry. Your crosses, maybe it's something with your health. Maybe it's something with your finances. Maybe it's something with your Christian faith. Maybe it's something with your relationships. And certainly, part of the cross we carry is all the chaos in our society today. I mean, with the pandemic and the protests and unemployment, etc. I recently read that in a poll that was taken recently, for the last 50 years, today and this time, Americans are the unhappiest they have been in 50 years because of all of this. But Christ is our Savior, and he is with us each step of the way, and he helps us to carry our crosses. Now, St. Paul also talks about his crosses. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, let me read them for you. I have worked much harder, been in prison more frequently, been flogged more severely, been exposed to death again and again. 5 times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. 3 times I have been beaten with rods. 1 I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I have been constantly on the move. I've been in danger from rivers, danger from bandits, danger from my own countrymen, danger from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the country, danger at sea, danger from false brothers. I've labored and toiled and often gone without sleep. I've known hunger and thirst and often gone without food. I've been cold and naked, and besides everything else, I face the daily pressure of my concern for all the churches. And you think you have problems? And then he goes on in chapter 12 of 2 Corinthians about this thorn in the flesh business. Now, Bible scholars think it was something to do with his eyesight. Remember, they didn't have ophthalmologists in those days, all the blowing sand and dust and so forth. And we know, of course, that in his epistles, he had a secretary write them all out, all these little letters in the New Testament, and then he simply signs his name in the end. But St. Paul doesn't elucidate exactly what that thorn is, but he says here, God has given me this thorn in the flesh to torment me. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away. But he said to me, no, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. Interesting, isn't it? No, God said, I'm not going to take your thorn in the flesh away from you. Because when you are weak spiritually and physically, then you are strong in the Lord. And isn't that true? When trials and tribulations come our way, our strength grows stronger because he's the only help ultimately. And of course, the Lord helps us carry all of our crosses, does he not? As he gives us word and sacrament. God's holy word, as we read it and study it and apply it to our lives, remembering our baptism daily, receiving the Lord's Supper frequently. This is our soul food from God to strengthen our faith so that we can carry our crosses, whatever they might be, bravely. And therefore, St. Paul says in Romans, right here, chapter 8, verse 18, I consider that our present sufferings are not worthy to be compared with the glory that will be revealed to us. I suffer, yes, but the best is yet to come. So hang on. The story is told of a man who came to Jesus one day and said, I'm sick and tired of the cross I have to bear. I want to exchange it for another one. Jesus said, come on to the warehouse, look all you want, and pick out another one. So this man walked around this huge warehouse looking all day at other crosses that were there. At the end of the day, he came to Jesus and said, I think I'll take this one right there. And Jesus said, now, isn't that interesting? You know what? That's the very cross you brought in this morning. You see, as we look around, we see that oftentimes our crosses are a little bit lighter than our neighbors. But whatever that cross is, God helps us carry it. And in the last verse of our gospel lesson today, whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. That means, of course, that we are to be in service to God and our fellow man. All the things we do are not to gain entrance into heaven. That's by grace, thanks to Jesus and his blood on the cross. But we are to live out our Christian life. That means loving our neighbor as ourselves. So God has given us all kinds of talents and abilities and opportunities. And God wants us to use those time, talents, and opportunities to show the love of Christ to those around us. A random act of kindness is something that we talk about today. So think about what you're going to do today to be kind and loving to someone else. The hymn we sang just before the sermon is one of my favorite hymns. Take my life and let it be. And it kind of sums up what we're talking about today. Take my life, take my moments, take my hands, take my feet, take my voice, take my lips, take my silver and my gold, take my intellect, take my will, take my heart, take my love,
take myself, and I will ever be only all for thee. That sums up our sermon today. My name is Larry Kuddart, and I approve of this message. So we rise for a promise. And now may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep our hearts and minds faithful to Christ our Savior. Take my silver and my gold, O Lord, everything for you and your kingdom. Amen.
Thank you.
soul, who being in any affliction, trouble, sickness, or agony, stands in need of your mercy and help and healing, all who are in necessity or distress, all who love us or hate us. O Lord, you are the helper of the helpless, the hope of the hopeless, the savior of them that are tossed with the tears of life. O Lord, be within me to strengthen me, without me to keep me, above me to protect me, beneath me to uphold me, before me to direct me, behind me to keep me from straying, and round about to defend me. We pray that to this church all your children may ever be welcome. Here may the little children love to come, and young men and maidens to be strengthened for the battle of life. Here may the strong renew their seek their strength and win for their life a noble consecration. And here may the aged turn their footsteps to find the rest of God in light and eventide. Here may the poor and needy find friends. Here may the tempted find help, the sorrowing find comfort, the sick find healing, and the bereaved learn that death has no more dominion over us. Here may they who fear be encouraged, and they who doubt have their better trusts and hopes confirmed. Here may the careless be awakened to a sense of their folly and guilt and to timely repentance. And here may the oppressed and striving soul be assured of that mercy and grace that triumphs over all. We remember the sick and suffering today. Remember Andrea and Kurt Adler, Jill Baldwin, Billy Bostick, Gwen Bostick, Pete Courtright, Peggy Harper, John Hedgecock, Mason Rose, Debbie Rayfield, and Libby Whitaker. O Lord, lay your hand of healing and blessing upon them and work through modern medicine to restore them to their bodily health in accordance with your holy will. We also remember the following families of Emmanuel Church: Leffler, Legg, Lowe, Ludrowski, Mangus, Mara, and Markham. And we also pray the family for Harold Markham. He died last Sunday, was given Christian burial from the church this past Friday. O Lord, we give you hearty thanks that you've called this your servant to his eternal rest and faith and trust in Christ Jesus. Comfort the family with the sure hope of the resurrection and of the glad reunion in heaven. These and all of our private prayers we confidently lay before you in the name of Christ our Savior, who has also taught us to pray together. Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
and the power,
and the glory,
forever and ever.
Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.